Good evening. I'm James Goodale, and you're watching The Digital Age. Got a great show for you tonight. It's going to be on the issue of whether we can win the war against virtual terrorism. Now, bin Laden, where is he? We don't know. Where is terrorism? It's still going on. So bin Laden doesn't need Afghanistan. He doesn't need a public base or a training camp to cause all the trouble that he causes, because he can use the net and use other tools of virtual terrorism. So we want to discuss tonight, can we win that war? You know, we hear about winning the war on terrorism, but how about this war? And we are very fortunate tonight to have a real expert, Michael Scheuer, who used to be known as Anonymous.
Yes, sir.
Who ran the CIA station. What was the name of the station?
Alec.
Alec Station, that chased bin Laden for many years. I want to say he got chased out of the CIA, but he didn't. But he wrote a book. And you will see by looking at this book that Michael Scheuer's name is not on it, because he is the famous Anonymous who wrote the book Imperial Hubris. This book received a lot of attention recently because the book attacked American foreign policy in Iraq, and it was written by an anonymous writer, and then the writer came out. He outed himself, and we all know that he's Michael Scheuer. Thanks a lot for coming by. I think it's a real treat for the New York audience to have you here.
It's my pleasure, sir. Thank you.
I want to ask you, in your book, in the introduction, you say that one thing that you've learned over the last few years, you wrote an earlier book,
yes,
and it was still anonymous, and what you've learned since the earlier book was that you didn't really fully emphasize the importance of the internet to bin Laden.
Yes.
What do you mean by that?
I had a limited view of the importance of the internet, thinking mainly in terms of communications, command and control for the organization, but Al-Qaeda and its allies are way ahead of where I was thinking. They have transferred so much of their propaganda, their political analysis, their actual training manuals to the internet, and have made them available in a way that, for one thing, cuts down on the need to travel to places like Afghanistan or Yemen or the Sudan to train. The training manuals are mounted on the internet in several languages, and so you can train in Miami.
Train in your
Bolivia.
Backyard.
Exactly right. And the other thing that they dominate the discourse on religion in the Islamic world, they have been in the forefront of mounting on their websites the texts of the Quran and of the Prophet's sayings and of Islamic scholars who they claim support their view of Islam and their view of this war. And so they're very sophisticated in the use of their internet. And my examination of their use of it was much too narrow in the first book.
What can we do about this?
It's very hard to do much about it at all. They're very knowledgeable about our legal system. Many times they mount their websites and their programs on American or Western servers, which are protected by law by First Amendment rights.
They put them on American servers?
Yes.
How do they do that?
It's I don't exactly know how they do it, but across the country we've had them, in Western Europe we've had them mounted, but they know they're safe from...
So that means they must give it to some American then, who the American doesn't know what he's doing.
I think that's right. I think that's just, and then they have multiple users. The military has tried to knock them off the internet, as I understand it, but they pop up again very quickly.
Well, do you think it's a good idea to attack these websites from your overview of what's going on? We want to get into how you look at the terrorism, its religious origin, so forth and so on, but generally speaking, do you think it's a good idea to attack, let's say, a site that's a Al-Qaeda site, but it's very Islamic in its nature? Does that do us any good?
I don't think it does. And the one thing it hurts is we have not, as a country or as a government, appreciated the degree to which our enemies are motivated by religion. And it's very clear in the discussions in the electronic journals they put on the internet that they discuss these aspects of religion, how it fits into their warfare, how it fits into their lives. And we can get a great deal of information and understanding of how they think by viewing the products that are on the internet. And frankly, if they're going to send a message, a command and control message to organize an attack or to actually execute an attack, they're going to use encrypted materials that are going to, we'd have to be awfully lucky to be able to break in time to stop. So,
Well, interesting. I've been talking about, I have to tell you, Michael, I've been talking about what you've been talking about for years on this show, and I have had code experts on, and I've had Daniel Benjamin on, and I've said to him, it's my judgment, just as a citizen sitting here, you know, being Sherlock Holmes, that the encoding ability of terrorists is new because no one's had that coding ability in the past. It comes from multiple sources. That's to say we had one code.
Yes.
You know, in the World War II from the Russians, one code from the Germans. Now we have multiple codes. And I've had a really large, you can't answer this question, but because you shouldn't, but a major question in my mind whether we can break those codes. But what you've just said, it seems to me a compromise reaction to my point, which is it's going to take time to break them.
Yes, it takes, as I understand it, and I don't know very much about it, it takes tremendous computer time on the Cray computers.
Yeah.
And there's an opportunity cost. If you devote everything to one thing, you lose something else. But with the encryption systems, as I understand it, that are available on the market, they can use, as you said, varied
systems. Just keep buying new ones.
Systems. Exactly.
Keep buying new ones. Yeah. You know, this isn't, you know, your book, your book doesn't get into this because you shouldn't get into this, since you are from open sources, and if you got into this in any particularity, you'd sort of take away the focus of your book,
yes.
Which is I'm sitting here as a citizen, I'm telling you what I learned, which you could have learned probably if you'd looked at the open sources. And if you were fortunate to have my background, but that would not take one into codes.
No.
Well, it seems to me that, going back to this question now, they have the use of the net, they have use of the codes. Don't they have these terrorists, is terrorists the right word?
I tend to think they're more like insurgents.
Okay, we'll come back to that.
All right.
Okay, so these insurgents, don't they have an advantage that's unequaled in a way? In any war that we've fought before? Maybe the Indians, you couldn't break the Indians' codes, but...
Well, they, they have the great advantage of having no fixed address.
Yeah.
So we have a hard time finding them in the first place. But they also have the advantage of speaking in Arabic or writing in Arabic.
Right.
They have the use of computers and modern encryption devices.
Right.
They also use, for very sensitive things, couriers, which are very difficult to intercept.
Yeah, now you do talk about couriers in your book, and of course a courier is harder to intercept, but a courier might be carrying an encoded disk, too.
Well, that's exactly correct.
Yeah.
There's no guarantee that if you stop the courier that he would know what he's carrying.
Yeah. Well, let's go back now. We've got the stuff up on the web, and you said probably isn't a good idea to attack a religious text. Is it going to do us any good? We might as well leave it alone. How did you feel about the way we handled Al Jazeera? First of all, when we had the attack on 9/11, the first thing we did was we rushed to stop Al-Qaeda coming into this country over Al Jazeera. Yeah. And Condi Rice went around and told the networks not to run it. She said there were codes in it. I didn't believe what she said. You don't have to comment on that. What did you think of that?
I think that it's emblematic of our refusal to consider Osama bin Laden a serious enemy, that somehow we can defeat him simply if he isn't visible to the world. And it also assumes that he doesn't have anything worth saying from our perspective. And I think we're still scorched by the litany of grievances the Ayatollah Khomeini described against our country of being debauched and degenerate and a lot of amorphous kind of condemnations. And we assume that's what bin Laden's up to, that he's raving and ranting. But quite frankly, bin Laden is a very rational actor. and he is a man who is, unusually for politicians, a man of his word. And so I think we make a mistake by not allowing Americans generally, but especially the intelligence community, to be able to hear what he has to say on a real-time basis. In addition, on a more propaganda level, it makes us look like hypocrites every time we try to close down freedom of speech.
Condi Rice has reported recently in the paper putting pressure on Qatar, the country that owns Al Jazeera, and telling Qatar to make a sale. What do you think of that as a PR question?
I think it'll
make a sale to someone else. They don't run anymore.
Sometimes it's better the devil you know. But the point I would make on bin Laden's statements and interviews and letters to the media, almost all of them have been on non-Al Jazeera venues. He's used various websites around the world. He's used some printed papers, Al Quds at Al-Arabi in London. So we may cut off some percentage, but it will be less than 20%. And at the same time, Al Jazeera has always edited those films, so we're not quite sure of what was entirely in them. And again, you might not like what he has to say, and we shouldn't like what he has to say, but it's better to know what your enemy's saying than to be guessing about it.
Now, do you think that the United States knows what our enemy is thinking and what it's saying? First of all, you corrected me when I said that Al-Qaeda was a terrorist organization. You said it's an insurgent organization. Do you think the United States understands what the insurgency is that envelops bin Laden and Al-Qaeda? Do you think we understand that?
I think the people who work it on a day-to-day basis understand it very well, that this is not, this organization of Al-Qaeda is nothing at all that resembles what we have termed terrorist groups over the past 25 years. Indeed, if we had injured any of those terrorist groups to the degree we've injured Al-Qaeda, they would have disappeared. Al-Qaeda was built on the model of the Afghan resistance groups that fought the Soviets. And so they're much larger than a terrorist group. They're much more specialized in the sense that the people we call terrorists are more or less their special forces. Then there is a whole group of people that fight in Islamic insurgencies around the world. Then there's a compartment, or a department rather, for finances, logistics, communications, religious guidance. But the main difference is Al-Qaeda always expects to be fighting a more powerful enemy. And so they always expect to be losing their leaders. And they put a tremendous amount of effort and thought into preparing succession for leadership. And we've seen it. Every time we've taken down a very important Al-Qaeda person, whether it's Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, Abu Zubaydah, Ramzi bin al-Shib, almost the next day Al-Qaeda announces the person who is going to take his place. So the vitality and the ability of the organization to replicate is in itself a problem that we have yet to really comprehend. Really, when we say we've taken down two-thirds of their leadership, we speak as if it is a sterile, dormant organization that we're reducing from 100 to zero. We really aren't.
Well, let's see if we can focus in on what their gripe is against us.
Yeah.
Now, you said a few minutes ago that Al-Qaeda was not necessarily focused on the weakness of our civilization, the debauchery, the godlessness, the overt sexuality, if one wants to call it that, looking from someone else's eyes. Is that really true? I mean, yeah. I think most Americans think that, as you said, Khomeini thought that we were debauched. Al-Qaeda doesn't?
They don't like our society. If they ran a government, it wouldn't look like ours. But think to yourself, how many people died for the Ayatollah because he didn't like the fact that we drank Budweiser or our women went to school? Very few. The people that died killing our troops in Lebanon did so under the cover of Khomeini's rhetoric, but they really were nationalists. They wanted us off the street. Bin Laden, I think, went to school on that. And part of his genius has been to focus on U.S. foreign policies, which are vastly unpopular.
Yeah, now let's just talk about that.
All right.
Because I think the great part of your book, how do I say that? A great part of your book. Your whole book is great, but one part, one, One part I really found very interesting and clarified a lot of things for me was the fact that bin Laden, what he seems to want is not to correct our morals, but he wants to correct our foreign policy. I find that really surprising. What is exactly he want?
He wants, his overall goal, I think, victory for him from his own perspective is to drive us as far out of the Middle East as he can.
Okay, so that's getting him out of the territory, yeah.
They want, but he is focused, instead of on the amorphous things the Ayatollah talked about, he's focused on our unqualified support for Israel, our ability to keep oil prices at a level that are acceptable to Western consumers, thereby denying the Muslim world increased revenue, our presence on the Arabian Peninsula, our support for other countries that appear to be oppressing Muslims, as the Russians in Chechnya, the Indians in Kashmir, our military presence in Islamic countries such as Yemen, in the island of Mindanao in the Philippines, and now in Iraq and Afghanistan. And the sixth thing is our support for tyranny, our support for the Muslim tyrannies from Algeria to Saudi Arabia.
Okay, so as I get it, if we withdraw everybody, all American forces from the Muslim lands, and if we drop our support for those countries which he doesn't like, Israel, any tyrannies, any Muslim countries that are being picked on, like Chechnya, and if we lower the gas prices, if we do that, generally speaking, the war is over?
No, sir.
Oh.
What I'm my argument is that we simply need to look at our foreign policies to make sure they still serve America's interests. Right now, we have only two options to fight this war: the intelligence services and the military. They will hold the ring for us for a while, but we have not yet begun to slow the growth of support for Osama bin Laden in the Muslim world.
Well, let me ask you one thing. Let me just come back to this point.
All right.
Because if this is what he wants, and his last message, I believe, was focused on foreign policy, in fact.
And I found
it in December. I found it quite surprising. If we take some solid actions, I ask you a question again. It won't do any good?
It would do some good in two ways.
What's left? I mean, if he wants to change our foreign policy and then we change it, what is he? And he doesn't think we're heathen, you know, perverters. What does he want after that?
What we have to do is several fold. We have to kill many more of them than we have. We have a plot.
No matter what?
No matter what. We don't have a choice between war and peace. The choice is a choice between war and endless war. We need to kill many more than we have, and it's going to be a bloody business for us also. But we can't kill 1.3 billion people.
That's 1.3 billion Sunnis, basically, right?
Sunnis are the largest proportion of that total, sir.
But 1.3 billion, are all of them following bin Laden, would you think?
No, but there's
you say a half a million?
There is a wide support for his view of the United States in terms of our policy. Mm-hmm. It's extraordinary that the reputable Western firms that are polling in the Middle East consistently show majorities in each country of 80 right. or 90% right. opposing our policies, but majorities and sometimes large ones envying the way Americans live. So when President Bush and Mr. Clinton say that they hate us for our liberties and our freedom and our way of life, the scientific evidence from the polls knocks that in a cocked hat, as does the fact that both Western Europe and the United States have huge immigration problems from the Muslim world. If those people thought we lived in a vile, ugly society, they wouldn't want to raise their children there. So what we need to do, I think, is to apply ourselves as a great power. We've done it too daintily so far. The people that that have guns in their hands against us are irreconcilables. They must be killed.
How do you kill them, though? I mean, you can't find them. First of all, they're, as we go back to the beginning of the show, they're computer enhanced.
Right.
And they don't have to be in training camps. As we started to say at the beginning, all they have to do is communicate through the net. Furthermore, they can communicate one another. They can encode the message and talk to each other. It's very hard to stop any kind of internet communication, whether it's encoded or not. That's not easy. You really got to sort of break in the home or the internet. You say we have to kill lots of them. How the hell are we going to find them?
Well, we can find them.
You think so?
The issue here again comes back to an insurgency. These people don't wear uniforms. And we have convinced ourselves through the mangling of our educational system and the uncandidness of our politicians that you can wage wars without killing people, losing people on your side,
yeah,
or killing innocents.
You're talking about a change of philosophy.
Well, it may be an introduction to reality more than a change in philosophy.
Right.
Americans win wars when we fight like we did against the Germans and the Japanese.
But we have to change our attitude so we fight that way.
Right.
Yeah. And our foreign policy, let's say, does take on Israel. Is there any hope, since Israel is a problem, it would appear that we're supporting use of Arab land, which is the number one problem, as I see it, or from what you tell me. Secondly, it's going to be very hard for us to withdraw support from Israel. So what?
We shouldn't.
We should not abandon the alliance
with the Israelis.
Oh, okay.
America's had a terrible track record of dumping allies over the past 20 or 30 years.
Right.
But clearly, what's contributing to our pain in the Middle East and the death of Americans is the view among Muslims that we will not do anything to control or to blunt what the Israelis want to do.
All right, so let's now talk about recent events. One, we've had a new elected prime minister in Palestine, okay? Secondly, we've had a big hawk, Sharon, indicate the time has come, he said recently. Now, let's suppose that we're able to get a peace, which I think looks better now than it has in some time. Let's suppose we do it. We've got peace now, what happens? Has that helped?
It helps, but it doesn't help to end the fighting. It helps to slow the growth of the enemy. As far as I can see at the moment, that's the only hope we have of a long-term win here. Because America is not well thought of in the Islamic world because of policy. The one thing a peace in Israel would do is to create an opportunity for America to be given the benefit of the doubt in the Islamic world.
Okay, so what now? Suppose we were to pull all our people out of the Saudi Arabia lands, all our bases.
We can't, because we're dependent on oil. You got energy policy comes into this too.
So we can't do that. So in terms of particular policies, the best would be Israel of all the problems you see.
It would be the best initially, and it'd be the quickest that could be done,
and that's
to have some impact.
And Clinton says he thinks terrorism would go down 50%, maybe too big a figure.
I think it's too big. Well, I can't argue with Mr. Clinton, but since Iraq, it's too big a figure.
All right, let's not talk about Iraq.
All right.
Okay. Now, you say in your book that one thing that's not exportable is democracy.
Yes.
Okay. Now, recently in Iraq, we had a first election. There'll be others. It was a surprising turnout, in some respects, I guess, greater than U.S. turnout, if that's even possible. It surprised everybody. People died to vote. Doesn't this help?
Well, what do we have is, it may help. I doubt it. It looks like the Shias decided to elect the Shias to dominate the Sunnis after 80 years of being dominated.
We got the Kurds in there, too.
Yeah, that's true. But it may help in the long run. But the problem we have as Americans is when we recommend to somebody that they have a secular democracy, look how good it's done for us. That's exactly correct from our perspective.
Yeah.
They have, look at the prosperity we have in America and the wealth, the level of welfare we have for most of our citizens.
Right.
In the Islamic world, it's not that Muslims can't be Democrats, don't want to be Democrats. The problem is there is no separation between church and state. And America's democracy.
Is that true in every Muslim state?
It's
not true in Turkey.
Except for Turkey. But in Turkey, even, the Islamist forces are growing, which don't see democracy in the same light as Ataturk did.
Right.
But until you have a civilization in which there's a separation between church and state, it's very unlikely that you're going to have a democracy similar to Western democracies.
You might
have a democracy.
Well, let me see, are you saying, look, if we have democracy in Iraq, even if the Sunnis were to participate in some fashion, that ain't going to turn us around in the eyes of the 1.5 billion people who need to change their attitude, because they'll look at Iraq and say, hey, it's not a theocracy. Well, it's just a democracy. So, you know, I don't care. That's not what they didn't do anything there.
Well, Mr. Goodale,
Jim,
we have, I think we have a theocracy being born in Iraq on the Shia side. The Shias are of extremely religious people. And just because we voted for...
Well, that's even better than. Well, that's better than. Okay, change the example. Then whatever happens. And
Jim, if we can create a democracy that survives without our bayonets, then the whole equation in the Middle East changes.
Oh, it does.
But I don't believe at this point that it would be a democracy we would find acceptable if we elected what if we elected a government led by a person like Osama bin Laden or a Shia like Osama bin Laden?
Well, I was gonna say. It seems to me if you've got some sort of democracy going, and then America gets out, and you still have an insurgent movement in Iraq, I don't see how that is persuasive to anybody. In other words, you would agree with that.
And we also have the whole bigger problem, as we have in Afghanistan.
So anyway, there's hope there, but I don't know if it'll work. But hope, yeah. Go ahead. Afghanistan. Talk about Afghanistan. Very pessimistic about Afghanistan.
Yes.
In this book, which was written before the election in Afghanistan, I would say you're more critical about Afghanistan than you are about Iraq. And I found that surprising.
Yeah. Well, first of
all, do you think it's hopeless there?
I don't think it's hopeless. I think the Afghans will find their own level at some point. But the election we just had, if you look at the returns, we simply see the reemergence of the traditional ethnic conflict in Afghanistan. The southern tribes voted for Karzai not because he was a Democrat with a small D or a good leader, but because he was one of their own. The other side was voted for by the minorities who've always been dominated by the southern tribes. So it looks to me like we've just drawn the line for more conflict. I could be wrong, but I don't think so.
So you think that whole thing is going to blow up?
I think it'll erode over time. I don't think it'll be a big blow up. It'll be a slowly growing insurgency.
Well, here we come to the end. All right. Now, the question we have tonight is, can we win the war against virtual terrorism? And virtual means any ability of the terrorists to communicate their ideas virtually or otherwise.
We are the greatest power on earth. I think we can compete with the enemy if we understand his motivation and attack him in a way that begins to limit his ability to grow in terms of support and people who are actually willing to pick up guns. Right now, we're losing. And until we can say to ourselves, these people are motivated by what we do and not who we are, it's very unlikely we are going to win this war at any level, be it military, political, or technological.
What we do and not what we are.
Right.
Michael Scheuer, thanks very much for coming
by. Jim, it was
a
pleasure. Right. Thank you, sir.
And thank you for coming by. And come by next week to hear more about the digital age. For the digital age, I'm James Goodale. Good night.